Tell me about Evening Shade. Burt is a hit again. I mean, you got to feel terrific.
You say that like I'm a grain cracker or something. That I
no, know. I mean,
I wasn't finished in the business.
I didn't totally
washed up. I had my own game show.
But you were down, right?
I was down. I was down. When you can't get a table at McDonald's, it's not a good thing here.
Yeah, how did Evening Shade come about?
I decided that I needed to do something drastic to sort of get the career primed a little. And I've always felt, at least other people have felt too, that I could do comedy in front of an audience. And I had never done that on television. And anything you haven't done in Hollywood makes you hot, you know. You haven't.
That's the rule?
That's the rule. I mean, he's never done a musical. He's never done the first time Kevin plays an Indian. Whatever, you know. So it's very big. It's very hot. So I have never been in front of a live audience. No sitcom. So I picked out the people that I thought were really funny. Larry Gelbart, of course, was doing features. But Hugh Wilson, who I think is truly, and the word genius out here is used a lot, but he is. And Linda Bloodworth, who's amazing, amazing. And I had a meeting with them and got along great with both of them. But Hugh's idea, which was a funny idea, of course, you know it's going to be funny with him, but was a bachelor, kind of an old bachelor, kind of John Forsyth gone wiggy, you know, and on an island. Alex Rocco and I were going to be these bartenders in a little bar, and I could see that I would have so much fun, but I can't chase another bikini down the whatever, you know. I can't do that anymore.
The road is
closed. Long. Yeah. Yes, I took the road not traveled, and I can't walk anymore. So I decided that the best thing I could do was to play which is always the where I've had the most success, to do what was in my life at that time, now, because I'm married and I've adopted a son, and I feel like Ozzie Nelson, actually.
Did you think it would work?
Yeah,
I mean, it's been a big hit, but you said to yourself, this is going to make it?
I knew it would work on one level. I didn't know whether it would work on a commercial level, but I knew that it'd be something I'd be very proud of, because I've always done well when I had good words, you know. I mean, the features that I'm the most proud of, and there's only three, were written by James Dickey, James Brooks, you know, James. I always look for James. And I knew that with Linda, it would be funny but have heart. With Hugh, I knew it would be funny, real funny. I didn't know about the heart. And it's turned out true.
And you're having fun doing it, right? That's evident.
Honest to God, the best time I've ever had in my life. In my life, I've never had this much fun.
What happened to Burt Reynolds? I guess nobody.
You know, I
was
saw
in
four
top.
Guys being. I guess they were critics. I don't know who critics are today, other than. Are Siskel and Ebel still alive? Are they alive?
They do late night television.
I think they're dead, but nobody's told them. But when you get your son of your own, your priorities change, and I don't care about either one of those guys now. Also, I'm in television, and I can say these things. Unfortunately, I used to say them when I was in movies, and these guys never forget anything.
They leveled you.
Are you kidding me? Level. But I saw these four guys on television, and one of the guys said exactly that. What the hell ever happened to this guy? And I think, you know, what's interesting about this town is that when you have a film that doesn't work, you're allowed one. You know, everybody has one. Some guys, I won't mention names, they've had 20, and somehow they still go on, you know. I had about two that didn't work. I'm talking about didn't work in the sense they didn't make money. Because I tried to do what everybody said you should do, which is to try different things, etc. And I was getting a little long in the tooth to play this
kind
bandit
person.
Character.
Is that all that counts here, the bottom line? That's it? Did it make money or it didn't make money?
I think it counts if you were... If you're not a critic's darling, which I never was. I was when I first started out, but that was before I started having such a good time. When you start having a lot of fun, then you have to you know.
The critics have darlings, that is, in other words, there are people they're going to like no matter what they do?
Stop it. How long have you been in the business?
I'm asking this seriously.
There are guys that couldn't get a bad review. I don't care what they did, because just by the body of their work and the things that these people have said about them before, it would make them look like a fool if they said, you know, he suddenly can't act. He must have had brain damage or something. What the hell's happened to so-and-so?
Well, what was it like for you to have it happen? I mean, you obviously retain your equilibrium pretty well. You were an enormous success. What, 10 years in the top in the box office? Not many people have had that in a run.
Well, actually, I was 5 years number one. I was 10 years in the top 10, but nobody had ever been number one. Duke and Clinton, a lot of guys have been there longer than 10 years. But nobody has ever been one 5 years in a row, except Shirley Temple and I Now Have Her Hair.
All right, one would assume you didn't have great financial pressure, you had a nice life in Florida, mm-hmm. Things were going pretty well for you.
Right.
When we come back, what's it like when you have it okay in one place and it's not there in the other?
I'm going to tell you some really interesting stuff.
Okay. He will, folks. We'll be right back with Burt Reynolds on Larry King Live. We'll be taking your calls for Burt.
Vodka and tonic, please. Thank you.
We'll be right. Don't go away. Stay there, Cisco Niebuhr. Don't go away. Our guest is Burt Reynolds, who in the middle of all of this is asking me about Jewish fighters.
Yes,
which,
I thought you'd know
no
about
sense.
That. I just thought you'd know.
Why you would get
Because you're
that.
A big fight fan.
Yes.
Well,
I'm
thought
a big
you
sports
know.
Fan.
Well, I know that.
Okay. Do you feel vindicated? Successful television?
No, I don't feel vindicated, but I'm not trying to be vindicated. There's not a question. The only revenge is living well. I mean, I'm happy, and that's my, I'm well. And that makes all those guys who were saying those things, and girls and whoever was saying those things, and thought that was very funny. And there's rumors out here I hear every day. I'm sure that we could talk about a story that's circulating out here. It's been circulating for 2 years about a leading man. That people, if I hear one more time from, always it's prefaced with, I was in the waiting room when he came in the hospital, and you hear this story. That waiting room must be bigger than Kansas. But I've always, and I think, wait a minute, why? And the more this story is told, if in fact this is a story that will never be proven untrue, but in my case, I lived and am well, so all those people that said those things, they must look real stupid now.
When you go in a restaurant or somewhere, and you're, mm-hmm. you're not a person who ducks, and you see people who really mm-hmm. you knew mm-hmm. let you down or who didn't come through, mm-hmm. what's your reaction to them now?
I don't have a reaction that's any different than I had before. I mean, most of the people that I don't like, I didn't like before this. There were a lot of people that didn't show up during those 2 years. There were a lot of people that surprised me and did. There were people that Clint Eastwood, who, not that I'm surprised that Clint was so supportive, but it isn't well known that he's this humanitarian, which he is, a wonderful man.
I mean, he was right there for
right there.
You don't have to tell me. Did a lot of people let you down?
Yeah, but I saved so much money in Christmas cards. I have maybe six cards I send out.
No, I mean where you were hurt, where you would expect them to fall.
Oh sure. Yeah, I naively felt that there'd be a whole bunch of people that I was crazy about. I thought was crazy about me, and I didn't hear from them.
Do you now feel differently about power? You said you had power, didn't know it.
No, power is seductive, sexy, interesting, corruptive, all the things that all the cliches, it's all those things. I didn't abuse it because I didn't flaunt it, but I didn't use it in the right ways. For a classic example on the way to use power the right way is Costner, where you go and make Dances with Wolves. Now, I guarantee you, however much Mr. Costner loves Indians, couldn't love them any more than I do. And I tried, but I didn't know how to do it. I'm not as smart as he is at that age. You know, when it took me, I don't think I finally got it all figured out until I was 50. And by that time, who cares, you know?
And now you have it figured out.
I have it figured out in the sense that I know how to make Burt okay. And I know the people to be around and the kind of people that I want my son to be like, and that, yeah, I know.
Are you happy now?
Yes. Yeah.
You don't need major films anymore?
No, I don't think I ever needed major films. I was an actor. What I think people have forgotten is that I always worked. I came on the scene, the critic's darling, as a young actor who was the new Marlon Clift, well, you know, and got sensational reviews for everything I did. And then after Deliverance, which was the turning point for me, it was my deliverance out of bad television and films, the other side of me, which is this kind of crazy side, said, Cosmopolitan? Oh, that seems like a real good idea. If the sane side had said, no, you can't do that with Deliverance. You see, you'll be nominated maybe for Deliverance. You can't go and be in a, you jerk, you can't be in a, make your clothes off in a magazine. It's not, people are not going to take, how can they, Olivier would not do this. This is not good. And I did.
It wouldn't allow you one error in judgment? You're supposed to be perfect?
I thought you were going to say a small error, and I was going to be very bugged. Yes, they would allow you to have, to make a mistake career-wise, but I don't think that was a mistake that, talk about men, the envy barrier, I mean, that women were finally able to put something on the wall besides all those silicone pictures of these ladies. And men used to put, you know, I know a lot of very intelligent men who used to put these up in the garage, et cetera, and say, I don't understand why my wife's bugged about that. So suddenly he came home and there was this guy, actual size. I was about that big at that time, you know, sitting in the magazine. And there I was in the magazine, on the wall, and everywhere. And I was doing a play that at that time in Chicago. I had no idea that it was going to have this kind of, because I thought it would just be kind of silly, you know.
A lot.
Woof. It was crazy. It was crazy.
Did you know it right away? This is an era?
Mm-hmm. Too late.
Too late.
Too late.
But you told me once, and this is true, the camera liked you.
Yes.
It liked you.
The camera, I think, sees inside you and knows when you're
because you being. Can't, yeah, we talked about it. You yeah. can't fool it.
No, you can't. And it knows when you're sitting there telling the truth and not the truth or faking it and all that. And there are people who should never do this show and have done this show.
Because in an hour, they're going to know what's real, what's...
In 5 minutes, they're going to know. Because it doesn't matter whether you're talking about gardenias or your wife or your whatever. It just, that thing just looks inside you and says, not a good guy, sorry, you know. It just decides. You know?
Yeah, it decides, mm-hmm. and it then decides. Transforms that to me. And you understood that as a filmmaker, right?
I mean,
you,
I understood
you,
it.
You talked to cameras.
I used to talk to cameras all the time. Lee Marvin told me that. The first job I ever had in my life was on M Squad, and he'd go over and he'd be talking to the camera. And I said, "What are you doing?" He said, "I'm just saying good morning, you know, because like if this guy don't like me, I'm dead."
We're going to go to your calls for Burt Reynolds. I want to cover a couple of other bases, and then we'll let you have a go. We were kidding. Sally Field.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think of her?
One of the best actresses I've ever in my life been in front of and behind. she also is, I think if you were going to go across the desert in a covered wagon and you could only take two women, she'd be one of them.
Why?
She's indefatigable, she's indestructible when she has a goal. Indestructible.
Is that good in a relationship?
No. It's great, though, if you're an actress. She also is one of the best mothers to her children that I've ever known in my life.
You turned down Cuckoo's Nest?
No, I didn't turn down Cuckoo's Nest. Cuckoo's Nest I wanted to do. I did turn down...
What did you turn down that you regret?
See, now, right away, Dunsat... I didn't turn it down. I had another job, but I should have just said, screw the other job and gone and done it. And it was the James Brooks movie that Jack won the Academy Award for.
Terms of Endearment.
Yeah. And it was...
would have come at a great time for you, too.
It would have been perfect. But again, it was at a time in my life where I promised somebody I'd do a film with. And I said, I can't do that. I got promised so-and-so. I mean, to me, it wasn't about that, you see. And that's my fault. But see, I wasn't a grown-up. I was a...
You mean you should have broken the promise?
No, I could have gone, if the guy was really as good a friend as I thought he was.
Oh, and you go to him and say, I got this
look,
part.
I got this. This is something that's very important to me, and we'll do your project later. You can't do it without me anyway, you know, so let's wait. And I never thought of that, you know.
When something like that happens, and then you go see the film,
mm-hmm.
you say to yourself,
I've never seen the film. I couldn't see the film. It would break my heart. Jim Brooks is one of the nicest, most wonderful, talented people in the world, and the fact that he still speaks to me is amazing to me. I mean, every time he sees me, he should go, what a jerk you are for not, I'm grateful for turning this down, what a jerk, you know. Jack Nicholson, on the other hand, should say, what a guy.
To Los Angeles for Burt Reynolds. Hello.
Yeah, hi there.
Hi.
I have a quick comment and then a question. First off, I was a tour guide at Universal up until a few years ago, and Burt Reynolds was one of the few big stars who took time out to come up and talk to the tour guides one evening, and really appreciated it a lot. Secondly, there is a legendary story that tour guides tell on the tour about you and the television show Riverboat, and then being fired and running into a certain actor who I think you know I'm talking about. Could you? Every tour guide tells it different. Can you tell the truth about that story?
Sure.
What happened?
What happened was, it's true, I did throw a director off the boat. And
physically.
And he could swim, thank God. He was being, not mean to me, but he was very mean to some extras and things. And I, at that time, I thought, I know, I'm not sure I want to be an actor anyway. So who cares, you know? And he was such a jerk, and I told him to lighten up, and he said something to me. And Duke used to have this thing, you can do anything you want, but don't put your hands on me. And he put his hands on me, I'm pretty sure he did. And he went airborne. And so they talk about that in the tour, and then shortly after that, they fired Clint and I, Eastwood.
Yeah, both, you dropped the same day, right?
Yeah, and they told Clint his Adam's apple stuck out too far, and his tooth was chipped, and he talked too slow. And I said, what's the matter with me? And they said, you can't act. And so we were walking to our cars, which, by the way, when we got there, our parking, our names were gone. They had painted them over in about 8 seconds. Yeah. And I said to Eastwood, you're in big trouble. He said, why? I said, because I can learn how to act. You'll never get rid of that Adam's apple. It's going to hold you back. You're not going to break a dime.
What happened to that director?
He drowned. No, what happened? He kept working, and he's still around. Makes a wide swath when he sees me.
To Richmond, Indiana with Burt Reynolds. Hello.
Hi, Burt.
Hi.
First of all, I'd like to say you look terrific tonight.
Thank you.
He looks great.
Thank you. I have a sweater on.
What I'd like to ask you is, would you mind sharing a personal anecdote, Lonnie on your first date?
Oh.
What you did with Lonnie on your first date.
Yeah, I don't mind sharing that. I tried to get her to go out with me for quite a long time, and she was she didn't want to because she thought I was that guy in the magazines, you know. And I kept trying and trying and trying, and finally, after literally a year,
of turndowns.
Yeah, I'm a persistent little devil, you know, and when it comes to blondes and somebody is soft and voluptuous and. Let's not get into that. And so I said, would you please just give me a chance, you know, and come down and meet my family. So
a new one.
She flew down to Florida, and you know what we're like, Larry, when we get them in Florida. I mean, I have a chance, right?
Yeah.
Flew her over the Christmas tree at the National Enquirer, which I find a strange dichotomy if you don't want to go into that. And I had a helicopter, that I dearly love, and my father said to me once that no man is as sexy as he is what he does best, and I fly this helicopter real good. And also,
You took her on a helicopter ride?
Yeah, I picked her up at the airport in my black helicopter.
No, she gets off the plane, and you said...
I said, you want to step over here to my helicopter? That's what I said.
And the two of you went...
She was dead in the water. I didn't have a chance. She came down there for 2 days, stayed a week and a half. It was very nice, and to answer your question, I think what we did, I'm pretty sure, and Melanie remembers everything, which hasn't been good for the relationship. we watched old movies. I love black and white movies, and I love that period. And I think I probably ran Sullivan's Travels, which is one of my favorite pictures.
Your loyalty factor, big. You once told me that's the biggest thing with you.
Yeah.
Loyalty, right? Your friends are your friends.
Well, it's
ups downs.
Yeah. It's the way it should be, isn't it?
Well, this is the wrong town for it, isn't it?
I'm not sure this is any different than a little town in Maine. What it is about is that whatever you give, you should get back, and that's basically what it is.
Well, I don't mean the town. It's a business where loyalty is hard to
It's not a good business for that, no, because there's a lot of fair-weathered friends here. But, you know, they'll eventually show their true colors. You know.